In this exciting episode, a comedian, a beatnik, and Perry walk into a courtroom. The verdict? Coolsville, daddy-o. Okay, so the joke's not funny. But for a case about a comedian, this one doesn't have a whole lot of yucks. What a drag, man. It's season 2, episode 18 of Perry Mason, The Case of the Jaded Joker. I'm your humble host, Jonathan Searcy, and my purpose here is pretty simple. Provide an audio companion to the greatest legal drama in television history, Perry Mason. I plan to do a pod for every episode of the television series, and as time permits, I'll look at some of those made-for-TV movies too. I'll be working through the series in the order in which the episodes were aired. Each episode, I'll give a brief refresher on the plot, and if the episode was based on a novel, I'll compare the book with its television adaptation. Next, I'll list some key pieces of trivia, as well as tackle the episode's main theme. We'll feature a Perry proverb, a moment of wisdom from the man himself, and then we'll finish with a post-case water cooler, where just like Perry, Della, and Paul, we can rehash the ins and outs of their adventures. But first, to the law library! Each episode in the Law Library, we return to prior cases to refresh our memories about Perry's past so we can find fresh precedents for future cases. In this episode, we encounter a forensic dilemma and the chance to set an unexplored Perry legal precedent. The provocative question at the heart of the case of the Jaded Joker is this: how exactly did the victim die? Now, in previous cases, we've wondered when someone was murdered. Recall, for instance, J.J. Stanley in the case of the Green-Eyed Sister, whose body ended up in a freezer and threw off the correct time of death. Or recall earlier in season 2, Charles Sabin from the case of the perjured parrot, whose time of death was misread by the bookish Mr. Langley. But have we ever had an episode where the means of death has been up for grabs? We find out that the victim in this episode, one Charlie Goff, suffered blunt head trauma and a gunshot wound to the head.
We found the bullet lodged in the brain, and we found injuries both to the left and the right sides of the brain.
Well, what could have caused these injuries to both sides of the brain?
How are the two related?
To the best of my belief, the injuries on the left side of the brain were caused by the penetrating bullet.
Well, the coroner refers to a textbook for his explanation.
In the book entitled Legal Medicine, Pathology and Toxicology, by Gonzalez, Vance, Halpern, and Umberger.
This is a real textbook, and it had a new edition, a second edition, that was published in 1954. Perry disagrees. He contends the blunt head trauma came first, then came the bullet. In fact, and this is where things get really interesting, we find out that it's our defendant, Perry's client, who fired a shot into an already dead corpse.
And I find Goff wedged under the desk. Danny's been here. Poor Danny. I shot the guy once and threw the gun under a chair and screamed.
Now, we're not given the ramifications of this evidence tampering inside the episode, but it's got to be a huge can of legal worms. We'll see if any future cases dig into that open can. For now, let's get to the plot of this episode. The Case of the Jaded Joker. Danny Ross is a washed-up comic. He lives with Freddie Green, a two-bit con-turned-right-hand man, and Buzzy, a sweatshirt-wearing beatnik who plays downer piano day and night. Well, Danny thinks he's got a chance of getting back into the game.
3 years I've been off television now.
They're all waiting for you. All the old friends, millions of them.
Standing between him and stardom, however, is Agent Charlie Goff, who seems more interested in getting a big-name advertiser than he does getting a big-name comic, his second chance. And that's just what happens. Goff gets his deal, but cuts Danny out. And Danny ain't happy.
I set this one up for you. This one, not the next one. This one!
I told you they wouldn't buy you, Danny. They said you were old stuff, deader than last season's jokes.
They said that?
As is often the case with Perry, a true square like Goff hasn't just angered one person. No, if you've angered one person, you've angered enough people to make people wonder who murdered you when you finally end up dead. If he's hacked off someone like Danny Ross, you can be sure there's a Lisa Hiller and Tom Drake. He's also jobbed.
But this entire Bryant Halsey idea was your own. You did it on your own time.
A vice president doesn't have any time of his own. At least that's what a court would say.
I promised you a big percentage of the profits.
Yes, but not in writing.
And don't forget Goff's lady friend slash bankroller, Sheila Hayes.
I tell you what, we'll go out on the town tonight. Drink champagne, have the craziest, silliest time we can think of. I'll expect you at,
Sheila, I can't see you tonight.
Do I need to mention that Danny's buds, Freddy and Buzzy, don't like Charlie Goff either?
Are you calling me a liar?
You better make it any clearer, yes!
Well, Danny is down, even after a visit to Perry. And Della certainly gets a morose vibe from the comic.
He makes me want to cry.
Freddy is picking up the same kind of vibe from his dude and goes with some black humor to stop Danny from committing suicide.
Try Yellow Bellies for relief of headaches. Five world-famous quitters guarantee it to be the chickenest way out of all troubles, small, medium, or large. Take the easy way out. Yellow Bellies are for you, and I do mean you.
No good deed goes unpunished. Danny's alive, and Fred has his gun. And then Goff ends up dead with a bullet from said gun in his body. It's Freddy who ends up getting arrested. And Buzzy has his most animated response of the entire episode.
I've got a warrant for your arrest. Charging you with the murder of Charles Goff.
Man, this is the wildest.
Some interesting details. Goff was crammed in the knee hole of his desk. And there's controversy, as we've discussed, about the head trauma and bullet wounds Goff has. Let's look at the potential murderers. We saw Lisa Hiller tidying up the crime scene, probably because she thinks her beau, Tom, did it. And of course, Tom is a motive. Let's not forget about Sheila Hayes. We see her hanging with Buzzy in a Los Angeles beatnik dive. That shows she really doesn't know what's going on in a cosmic sense. Jokes about her jumping from the Goff frying pan into the Buzzy beatnik fire aside. Is it a crime to hang out in beatnik dives? Not really, I guess. She's clean. That leaves Danny or Buzzy. Now, Danny didn't have the gun.
If Freddy killed Goff, he did it for me, so I'm the guilty one, not him. And you should be sending me to the gas chamber, not him.
As for Freddy, we get some damning evidence about what he did to Goff's body. We know Freddy's not guilty, though, and there are probably going to be repercussions for messing up evidence in that particular way. So, that just leaves us with good old Buzzy.
But the squares. Oh, the squares. Tell me about the squares. Go, go, go. Run through the ruts. Splash mud on clean little people. Stay in the muddy rut. Splash mud at the sun. Wear a mask to hide a muddy face.
If you're confused, so am I. It's all about as clear as the mud that Buzzy says is smeared all over the square's face. Let's just say that Paul Drake doesn't have much time for the beats.
It's a beat joint. No liquor, no life, no laughs. They just sit around hating themselves.
Also, Trag thinks their lingo is worth parodying.
Don't bug me, Granny. I'm one of the cool ones. I don't dig slick chicks trying to goof me up. Daddy-o.
All we know, Perry's no square, and it's time to get trivial, shall we? Each episode in our trivia section, I give you three takeaways. A Paul is a subject worth investigating more. A Della is something about a particular actor or actress in the episode. And a Perry is something we learn about our intrepid hero. Our Paul this episode involves soap manufacturers. Maybe this one has a really easy answer, but I certainly don't know it off the top of my head. Charlie Goff is crowing loud and long about the Bryant-Halsey account.
I just got the Bryant-Halsey account. On my mother's grave, $8 million bubbly bucks.
It's $8 million from a soap maker to sponsor a comedy show. So this episode's Paul prompt is this. Who's the real-life soap manufacturer that Bryant-Halsey could be a stand-in for? Is Bryant-Halsey really a thing? Is it a fake version of a famous company? Tell me more. Our Della this episode concerns Frankie Lane, probably the biggest entertainment star to appear on Perry Mason thus far. Lane's entertainment career started in the 1930s and didn't end until the 21st century. He sold over 200 million records and earned the nickname Mr. Rhythm. In retrospect, the truly shocking thing was that the show booked Lane and then didn't make him the defendant. My theory, if he was defendant, he couldn't have appeared on the stand and delivered pretty good performance as a hostile witness, you know, because Perry doesn't really do that with his witnesses.
Radio, 10 o'clock news. Somebody rubbed out friend Charlie Goff.
Lane was born Francesco Paolo Lovecchio in Chicago. His dad was a barber who supposedly shortened the hair of one Al Capone. Lane sang at church and in his teens became a singer for a house band in the Windy City. And after spending some time on the West Coast managing singers and trying out for movie work, Lane landed his first hit, That's My Desire, in 1947.
And reminisce with you, that's my desire.
Lane racked up gold records with names like Mule Train and Cry of the Wild Goose while touring with conductor Carl Fisher. He finally hit the big screen, singing songs, and in 1953 started singing title songs for both films and TV shows. You can hear him bellowing the theme songs to Man Without a Star, Gunfight at the OK Corral, and my personal favorite, Rawhide, the TV show that ran from 1959 to 1966.
Keep rolling, 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 though the streams are swollen. Keep them doggies rolling, Rawhide.
Lane was wildly popular in Britain, where he had a number one song for 18 consecutive weeks, a record at the time. And in the early 21st century, a song of his called Song of India from an album hit the charts in the UK, giving him a hit at the tender age of 85. Interesting note, Lane was a champion of civil rights. He helped support fellow singer Nat King Cole's short-lived TV show, and he was part of a free concert with other artists that supported MLK Jr.'s Selma to Montgomery marches. He married the actress Nan Gray in the 1950s and stayed married to her until her death in 1993. If you're interested in learning more about this jaded joker, you can check out a couple of biographies. They're easily found. And there's also a 2.5-hour documentary narrated by Lou Rawls called Frankie Lane, An American Dreamer. You go, Frankie! Our Perry this episode involves our intrepid hero knowing the definitions of hip lingo. He helps Della out here with the definition of schnook.
Perry, what's a schnook?
That's kind of a dope. A likable dope.
And all this is before Barry has a heart-to-heart with Buzzy, wherein our intrepid hero shows his ability to speak fluent beatnik.
What are you, Buzzy? I'm Beat Daddy.
Don't let anyone ever accuse Perry of not having his finger on the pulse of the culture. The theme for this episode is laughter. Admission, I rarely find the laugh-out-loud denouement segments of Perry Mason funny. The straight-out, set-up, punchline jokes are rarely laugh-out-loud for me. To me, Perry's humor is best when it is droll. I think of this one-liner from the case of the Sunbather's Diary.
I don't like it, Perry.
No, I'm afraid the photographer didn't capture the real me.
So with that as background, we get a setup of having an episode about a comic who really doesn't provide many laughs. Now, admittedly, the title tells us he's jaded, but it's hard to see at any point where the humor is that would have made Danny Ross a hit. You get all you need to know from the fact that Danny's hanging out with Buzzy the Beatnik, and here's Paul's summation of the Beatnik ethos.
It's a beat joint. No liquor, no life, no laughs. They just sit around hating themselves.
Not too many laughs there. As a result, we never get a sense of what Danny's act would have been like were he to have reclaimed his lost glory. Now, it's been said that history repeats itself first as tragedy, then as farce. This episode illustrates that principle by giving us Buzzy's dismal analysis of his own crime in Beatnik speak.
What gives with the squares, Buzzy? They don't make a baby. They don't swing. No chance. Only a chance to be born again. Like you did with Goff? Goff was a square. He didn't belong.
The murder is tragic. His explanation of that murder is no less tragic. What a bum trip. Side note, there were a lot of notes that got passed between Earl Stanley Gardner and the show producers about the Beatnik philosophy represented by Buzzy, and reflecting on how much the script writer should assume the audience knows about what it is Beats actually think. What we end up getting is sort of a half-baked bogus exposition of reincarnation, social typology, and self-righteous nonsense. In any case, when Lieutenant Trag, a square if I've ever seen one, ends the episode imitating hipster jive, man, is it farce.
Well, I'm glad this one's over. I'm Beat.
Dig the hipster.
And you know what? It's the funniest part of the entire episode. I laugh out loud every time I hear Trag's goofy send-up. Raymond Burr, meanwhile, pulls out his trademark quiet smile as the episode ends. He knows the joke just might be on Trag as much as it is on Buzzy. Now, it's time for a Perry proverb. A standing admonishment from any Perry Mason judge for a bickering DA and defense attorney is this: counsel will refrain from personalities. This episode's Perry proverb comes from a textbook example of this exchange of personalities. Perry objects to Hamilton Berger calling the gun the murder weapon. So Berger retorts,
"Your Honor, Mr. Mason knows perfectly well that he's standing on a technicality."
And then Perry gets his.
"Your Honor, Mr. Berger's devotion to the obvious sometimes causes him to confuse my client's interests with standing on a technicality."
What I love is that this Perry proverb is so effective that Hamilton can only mutter it under his breath.
Devotion to the obvious.
Perry's rhetoric is getting under Hamilton's skin, and of course, it proves not to be a technicality. Perry is right. The means of death ends up revealing the true murder. It wasn't the gunshot wound that killed Goff. Now, let's grab a swig from the water cooler.
You know, there is one thing I don't understand.
Go on, Paul.
In our last episode, The Case of the Romantic Rogue, we asked how much money Harry West's Encino property would be worth.
He also owned 2 acres in Encino. You know what they're worth.
Today. We got some answers from my dad and Aunt Myra. My dad found a 1.82-acre lot on sale for a cool $1.3 million. Extrapolated to 2 acres, that's about $1.4 million. Encino is in Los Angeles County. It's one of the best places to live in California. Lots of restaurants, coffee shops, parks. Young professionals and retirees live there. That comes from my dad's research. Aunt Myra added that the Realtor.com standard cost was a little bit higher than what my dad found. On average, a half-acre lot will run you $1.3 million, which extrapolated out means, we're getting expensive, right? We're close to close to $5, $6 million for what Harry West is sitting on. We also find out that it's an enclave of the San Fernando Valley, filled with quiet blocks of big houses. It's close to Bel Air and Brentwood, Sherman Oaks. And in general, Encino has a small town feel that makes its amenities and its quiet neighborhoods something to be desired in the hustle and bustle world of LA. Thank you so much to Aunt Myra and my dad for doing that work. Some other notes we received since our last episode. I love this note from April, who said she had a customer who came into her whose first name was Rubaiyat, and she was excited to tell him that his name meant poetry, which we discovered in the case of the glittering goldfish when our murderer quoted from the Rubaiyat of Omar Khayyam. And she said thank you because she knew about that as a result of the podcast. Delightful. We also received a note from Nancy, who gave us a little bit about her history with the show, which is extensive. And then she proceeded to demonstrate that knowledge by correcting errors I've made in previous episodes and adding some wonderful bits of trivia and analysis. Two of my favorites, she sent like 15. My favorite is she points out in the case of the fraudulent photo that they refer to Hugh Marlowe as a young DA, even though Hugh Marlowe, age 48 when he shot that episode, William Tallman, 44 years old. So, young? Maybe not. She also pointed out that Eva Martel, the actress played by Maggie Mahoney in the case of the Barrow Brunette, is the mother of Sally Field. I didn't point that out. And also that Lorene Tuttle's daughter, now Lorene Tuttle is from the case of the Substitute Face, her daughter was married to composer John Williams, and her son, the lead singer of Toto. Absolutely delightful. As always, I'd love feedback about this particular episode or the podcast in general. Was there something about this episode you'd like to comment on, or something that you'd like to correct? You can leave comments or send me an email at theperrypod@gmail.com. You'll find the link in the show notes. All PerryPod episodes are available via Spotify, YouTube, and iTunes. Thanks so much for joining me on this pod journey. Join us next time as Perry gets involved in a domestic pet dispute. It's the case of the caretaker's cat. Until then, this is Jonathan Searcy saying, keep on walking that Park Avenue beat.